Of the virus, you know, but you and I know that there are reports all over the world of people that had the virus but never visited the hospital and they recovered naturally. That tells you one thing: there are people, perhaps in New Zealand too, that had it, and unknown to the government, they recover by themselves. Praise the name of the Lord. And that will show you the dimension of mercy in protecting the country too. Praise the name of the Lord. Because it could have spread. This year, millions of people have died. Millions of people have died. I try to understand the heart of man, but I'm still not able to understand the heart of man. It has not turned into more church attendance. It has not stopped people from drinking and committing sin. It was only during the lockdown that people were sober and afraid of death. As long as that suffering was past, people went back to their ways of life. And God wanted to use that to bring humanity back to Him. Because we are closer to the end. And the beginning of the end is about to happen. Praise the name of the Lord. Two prayer points. Say, Lord, I'm grateful for the gift of life. And let me not waste the opportunity to live again. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I'm grateful for the gift of life. And please, let me not waste this opportunity to be alive, to live again. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. We're going to pray and say, Father, we take authority over the devil and every word-eating spirit. Eating spirit. The spirits from hell that does not allow the word of God to produce results in our life. Can we just pray in the name of Jesus? Lord, we take authority over the devil concerning this service today. And we take authority over every word-eating spirit. Father, have your way in our midst. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, before we do this quickly, I think we should celebrate our nursing mothers this morning. Let's clap for them because we have created a new seat for them. If you're watching our videos, the reason we did that is that number one, you are closer to the kitchen now. So that you can, nursing mothers are not far from the kitchen. It's easier. You have easy access to the kitchen. You have easy, mommy, I want to go to the toilet. Praise the name of the Lord. You have easy access to the toilet as well. Number two, if you watch some of our videos, in fact, I watch one. The culprit in that video is Ebuse, actually. So we have arrested him and detained him for this side of the church too. Praise the name of the Lord. He was screaming. He was even screaming. Screaming is even more than my preaching. Maybe when is that preach also last week? I think I'm not too sure. Maybe screaming was loud. So please just join us and celebrate our nursing mothers as they move to their new location. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
This morning, let's say I believe and confess. As I've been taught the word of God today, say my heart, you'll be fruitful with the word. Come on, say my spirit, you'll be alive. Say my understanding, you produce result. Say my body, you be in health. Lord, I will not be the same again. Within this short word, you will transform my life spiritually. Make me a fruitful Christian and use me for your glory this month. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. We had a vision about 2 years ago and we launched it. And ever since, we've decided that I'm persuaded that that vision will work. One of the things that you do when you come to a place and you want to preach the gospel, which we have done in this church for about 3 years now that we planted the church, was you want to find out God, what is hindering people in this land from knowing you as their Lord and personal Savior. There are two things that God told me. Number one, there are three things that I received from the Lord, and I'm very persuaded that it is the key to the evangelization of New Zealand. God told me that there are a lot of people in New Zealand that hate God. They personally just hate God. Why? I don't know. So if you're going to be able to win them for the Lord, then we are going to trust God to help them to love Him. Some of them have experiences that made them to hate God, I wouldn't know. Some of them were not even raised to love God. Number two, God also told me that this land, a lot of people love pleasure more than God. Actually, they love pleasure more than God. And if you go around, don't touch their pleasure. Because if you touch their pleasure, you become their enemy. Churches don't even want to touch their pleasure. I have a friend who belonged to a big church, and one day in the midst of the church, he was saying, we are going to talk about our sin, we are going to confess our sin. And the lead pastor called him and said, don't make people uncomfortable in church by talking about sin. So that's why you see people. You want to talk? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people who hate God.
Yeah.
Do you think a lot of those people actually believe that God exists? Or they hate the idea that we have, you know, is a God? But you actually, so if you hate God, then you know God exists.
Yeah.
So do you think these people actually believe in God, or they just said,
like,
they said, don't be religious,
Yeah, it's very difficult to answer because I don't know their mind. But the truth is this, if somebody says he hates God, if somebody says there is no God, behind their true self, they know that there is somebody called God. It's just they don't want to acknowledge him. Praise the name of the Lord. The third thing, and this person said, don't make people too comfortable about sin. And then that my friend said, okay, can we teach eschatology? He said, no, if you teach eschatology in this church, talk about rapture, talk about hell and all those things, you are going to make it your opinion. Praise the name of the Lord. And this is the kind of land that we have. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, the top truth that I discovered from God is this. That's why I want to talk to us this morning, not preaching to us, not speaking to our head, but speaking to our heart, is that God now told me and said, the only thing that will win this land for God, love. I had it clearly in my spirit. He said, love is the language of this generation. You may not be able to act aggressively like we act in Nigeria to preach the gospel here, but people can reject your gift. People can reject your invitation to your church. People can reject tracts. People can reject reading the Bible or reading anything that is religious. But I've never seen somebody that reject the gift of love. And that's why this gospel campaign that we started 2 years ago is focused on using love to reach sinners for Christ, making friends for Jesus. Can we all say making friends for Jesus? In other words, you have to show people love in order to reach out to them. A lot of us have neighbors. Count the number of neighbors that you live around. You think if you are going to, some of them don't even go to church, they don't even believe God. But do you know you can invite them for lunch? And then you have opportunity to share the gospel with them. Some of them are even sick and we can pray for them to be healed. But they don't even want to be prayed for to be healed. So how will they experience the power of God? Love remains the language of these generations. Praise the name of the Lord. And that's why this Make a Friend for Jesus is revisited this month, because this is the month that we dedicate to talk about souls, soul winning, to talk about evangelism, to talk about the reason why some of us have been born again and the rapture did not make you to disappear and go to heaven. Praise the name of the Lord. So this campaign, Make a Friend for Jesus, what is it all about? It simply means that every week, each and every one of us will make attempts to make a friend for Jesus. Make a friend for, look for somebody maybe in the mall, in your working place, in your neighborhood, that you will just befriend with the aim that eventually you will lead them to Christ. Because if you use any other method, there's a possibility they're going to reject you. But if you start with friendship, it will start with making friends with them, it will be easy for you to. Now you're going to help me to do some calculations. Praise the name of the Lord. If you make a friend every week, how many friends will you make in a month, church? If you make a friend for Jesus every week, how many friends will you make in a month?
Four times.
How many weeks do we have in a month?
I wasn't good at math.
So, if we, okay, we all agree it's four.
Yeah.
Okay, let's clap for ourselves. Now, if we make one friend for Jesus in a week, then we are going to make four friends in a month. If we make four friends in a month, how many friends are we going to make in a year? 48 friends. Wonderful. If each and all, every one of us, I'm guilty as you are, if each and every one of us had made one friend per week and had made one friend this whole year, and you have won 48 people to the Lord, how many people do you think are going to be in this church now?
A lot.
But the vision remains. We're going to keep talking about the vision so you understand that if you make one friend for Jesus in a week and you make 48 friends for Jesus in a year, soon and behold, very soon, the whole of New Zealand will be filled with Christians. Praise the name of the Lord. We are also told in the Bible that for every sinner that repented in heaven, there is joy. They threw a party in heaven. So imagine also what constant joy our lifestyle will bring to God and his angels. Constant party every week because of Sister Queen. Constant party in heaven every day because of Brother Tupper is here today. People just say, you just go to heaven and say, this week there's party. Who caused the party? Oh, Brother Tupper has just won a soul for the Lord. And next week again, who won a soul for the Lord? Sister Queen has won a soul for the Lord. And every week, Sister Queen is winning a soul. Now, who do you think God will be thinking most about? Those who create parties for angels in heaven, or who don't create parties for angels in heaven? Now, pray this prayer. Say, Father, let my life every week create a party for angels in heaven. I'm serious. That is what in the Bible. He said there is joy in the presence of God and the angels. Each time a soul is won to the Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I pray that your life will create a party in heaven and create joy for angels and God in Jesus' name. This I know, no man or woman, and I mean a child of God, can daily make heaven to rejoice, will live in sorrow. You can't live in sadness of any kind. When God's heartbeat becomes your personal project, when preaching the gospel becomes your lifestyle, we can be sure our deepest desires and wishes will never go unattended to by heaven. If you're thinking about heaven, heaven will be thinking about you. Praise the name of the Lord. But the challenge is this. The challenge is this. I love some statistics. I love statistics a lot. I would have liked to reel out those statistics. But I've taken a few. Do you know that every second, millions are born into the world? See, let me tell you one funny joke. You think the whole world has lost millions of people during the lockdown, am I right? You'll be surprised. Because of a lot of cuddling between couples, triple children have been born. In 1993, when Nigeria was locked down, there were more babies born in Nigeria than any time in the world. My mommy almost got shot during that crisis in Ibadan. She was attempting, there was no way you could cook in the kitchen. You can't buy petrol, you can't buy fuel, you can't buy kerosene. So she was trying to use the backyard to use some wood to cook for us. And they started shooting. It was that terrible. For 3 months, the whole country was locked down. I don't know, maybe you witnessed that lockdown. How many of us witnessed the lockdown? 1993. More babies were born. And a lot of people died. So you see that suffering does not really make human bodies to deny themselves of pleasure. May God make us to love God. Now, millions are being born every day. Millions are leaving the world every day. Millions too are going to hell every day. Now look at these statistics. So, if you're going to make preaching the gospel your daily lifestyle, I want you to have the reflection on this. This statistic says 95% of all Christians have never won a soul to Christ. Now you can check up yourself. You claim to be born again. You claim to be a child of God. You claim to love God. Have you won a soul for Christ? He said 95% of Christians have never won a soul for Christ. Number two, he says 80% of all Christians do not consistently witness for Christ. He now says less than 2% are involved in the ministry of evangelism. In other words, the truth about it is that less than 2% of our faces are actually preaching the gospel in the church. He now goes and says 71% do not give towards the financing of the Great Commission. It doesn't have to be your church. If you know somebody that is preaching the gospel, you can give towards it. Praise the name of the Lord. I was telling you that, let me not distract the preaching so that I can finish in time. Let's pray this prayer point. Hold somebody's hand and say, Father.
Father.
We don't need to speak above our head and say, Father, please make my brother a soul winner. In the name of Jesus, pray. Lord, make my brother a soul winner. Lord, make my brother, make my sister a soul winner. We have been saved in order to save others. Lord, we have been saved in order to save others. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Say, Lord, make me a soul winner. In the name of Jesus. Lord, make me a soul winner. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Point to me and say, Father. Say, revive my pastor to be a soul winner. In the name of Jesus. I need the prayer much more as you do. Lord, revive my soul winning in the name of Jesus. Give me more strategies to win souls. Give us more strategies to win souls. In Jesus' name we pray. Now I'm going to challenge you with two illustrations before I go into the outline briefly. I hope I'll be as brief as possible so that you can get it and then we can go home and rejoice. A particular blind, illiterate soul winner. A blind, illiterate soul winner. And that story was titled Lost Opportunity to Save a Soul. It says a missionary to Africa told the story of an elderly woman who was rich with the gospel. Though she was blind and could neither read nor write, she wanted to share her newfound faith with others. So what did she do? She went to the missionary and asked for a copy of the Bible in French. When she got it, she asked the missionary to underline John 3:16. We say, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. She actually highlighted it in red and marked the page it was on so she could find it. The missionary wanted to see what she would do. So one day he followed that woman. In the afternoon, just before school let out, she made her way to the front door. And as the boys came out when school was dismissed, she would stop one and ask if he knew how to read French. When the student says yes, she will ask them to read the verse that was marked in red. Are you following, George? Then she will ask, do you know what this means? And then she will go on and use that story to preach the gospel to them. What is the end result? The missionary said that 24 of the school boys that lady led to the Lord had became pastors. Clap your hands and celebrate with them. For the first time in my life, I got close to Gideon's International this year. And I've been involved in one of the outreaches in town. We went to a secondary school. This same thing that this lady did, it was what we did. We stood in front of the school when the children were just closing school and we're just giving out Bibles to them. Some of them were excited. Some of them, their parents have told them not to collect it. Surprised. But do you know, I also went to Gideon's conference this year and I had testimonies upon testimony of people that have become pastors. Somebody that almost died in his hotel room, but because of Gideon's Bible, he picked it up, got read it, and got born again. Or somebody, a school child that was given a Bible, dumped it somewhere, and the thought of suicide was coming to him or her, and then she decided to reach out to that Bible, read it, and got born again. Praise the name of the Lord. That tract you give out, that Bible you give out, that gospel you share, it will not die in the heart of the people you have shared it with, but one day may you get them born again in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's look at the second part of the story. And this one was told by that popular gospel evangelist, D.L. Moody of America. D.L. Moody told the story of his conversion this way. He said, when I was in Boston, I used to attend a Sunday school class. And one day, I recollect, my teacher came around behind the counter of the shop. That's why I've been a pastor for a while, but I don't neglect children. Some of these children will get born again in that room. Some of these children, the Bible verse that is going to make them to eventually get born again in life will be dropped right in their heart in that room. Please, let's encourage them to come and hear that Bible verse. Let's encourage them to come and watch those things. Because that is the seed for the life of God in the future. He says, and one day I recollect my teacher came around behind the counter of the shop I was at work in and put his hand upon my shoulder and talked to me about Christ and my soul. I had not felt that I had a soul till then. I said to myself, this is a very strange thing. Here is a man who never saw me till lately and is weeping, crying over my sins. And I never shed a tear about them. But I understand it now and know what it is to have a passion for men's souls and weep over their sins. I don't remember what he said, but I can still feel the power of that man's hand on my shoulder tonight. Are you with me? Did you get what I'm trying to say? He just went to Brotokwe and put his hand on his shoulder and talked about his salvation. Hell is real. Don't continue your sin. And left. The man did not even remember hell is real. The man did not even remember, but the hand that was on his shoulder and the fact that that man was crying because he doesn't want him to go to hell eventually led the guy to the Lord. Clap your hands and celebrate Jesus. Let's pray a prayer again. Say, Lord, make me a soul winner. I said, make me a soul winner. I said, make me a soul winner. The concern and tears of a godly teacher resulted in the conversion of a man who saw a million souls saved in his evangelical campaigns. Those are the kind of people me I want to copy. Praise the name of the Lord. That one day I will stand and preach in a crusade and 1 million people will be saved. In Jesus' name I pray. I tell you the story of another person in my country. True life story. The guy went to preach to a man, a smoker. And when he was preaching to the smoker, just like as you are looking at me, they were looking at each other. As the guy was approached the smoker to preach, he knew he was coming to preach to him, so he lighted his cigarettes. And rather than listening to him, he was trying to distract the preacher with the smoke. And you know, if he's doing like this, and you know, if he's puffing his cigarette and doing like this, that would be fine. You know what he was doing? He will inhale the puff and look at the preacher's nose and mouth and do. And the guy continued to preach. He will inhale the cigarette and look at the preacher's face and blow it on him. The guy continued to preach. He got to a point in the preaching, the guy was crying. And then at that point, when the guy was crying, the preacher was crying, he caught the attention of the sinner and he says, "Why are you crying?" And he said, "Well, actually, I was looking at the head of your cigarette. That as you were puffing it, there's this red glow from it. And I was just imagining hellfire. And I was just imagining you not burning in the hellfire." That word broke that guy down. He gave his life to Jesus. But don't forget the resistance based on love from the gospel preacher. As we go to Margaret May on the 26th, please join us, I beg you. Somebody will get a Bible from you. Somebody perhaps will get a tract from you and will get born again that day. We don't do it every time. God will give us grace to be able to do it every time. But at least we do it once a year. Let's make it consistent. Praise the name of the Lord. 11:30 to 2:30 in the afternoon. If you don't have to make a friend for Jesus, you can book for it. If you don't want to book for it, just get your blue jeans and get a white shirt. Let's do it together. Clap your hands and celebrate Jesus. So as I close today, I just want to share with us two things. What is the worth of a soul? So that we should know that it is important for us to keep doing it. Not just on Margaret May, but for every opportunity that we... How much is the value of a soul? $1 million? What is a soul worth? $10 million? How do you value a soul? Praise the name of the Lord. $100 million? $1 billion? Well, how long also do you think a soul will live? If you can't value a soul, how long do you think a soul is going to live?
Forever.
Forever and ever. Praise the name of the Lord. And let me give you this. In Mark Gospel chapter 8. Mark Gospel chapter 8. Verse 8 to 36. Praise the name of the Lord. Are we there? Let's read it together. We have not even read any scripture. Let's go together. I want to go. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Let's go. Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 16. How long will a soul live? And what is the value of a soul? Praise the name of the Lord. Let's read it. I think this should be our memory verse quickly. It says, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Now you will understand this when I say this. When a soul is lost, when a soul is lost, when a soul is born, that soul is born forever. Let's start from that. When a soul is born, that soul is born forever. Human body is not just a body. You as a person is a composition of three things. We are each what? Composition of what? Three things. Do you know? The body, the spirit, and the soul. Let's go to the Bible. Genesis chapter 3, verse 19. Genesis chapter 3, verse 19. Read it with me, God, church. It says, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. For out of it was thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. Is he referring to the human spirit? No. He's referring to the what? Human body. That tells you that the Bible establishes the fact that we are made of dust. And when we die, the dust, which is the skin, the teeth is even falling off at 50. I've removed one. Some of us know. You understand what I'm trying to say? The body goes back to the ground. What happens to the soul? What happens to the spirit? Look at Genesis. Look at Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. Let's go. Let's read the church. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Now we know what happened to the body. Where does the body go back to? The ground. Where does the spirit go back to? What happens to the soul? Job chapter 32, verse 8. So God owns the spirit. Nothing happens to the spirit. The spirit is the breath of life. The spirit is what makes our heart to begin to continue to breathe. And the moment the body collapses in death, it goes back to God. But the real you, which is the soul, lives forever. Look at it. It says, but there is a spirit in man, and the inspiration of the Almighty give them understanding. That is your soul. When a soul is born, that soul lives forever. That establishes another thing, which is like this one. Like what I just said now is like equation one. That establishes the second thing. When a soul is born, it burns forever, it lives forever. When a soul is lost, too, what happened to that soul?
Lost forever.
Hallelujah. Amen. Not for a time or for a season. Not for a time or for a season. Not for a year. Not for 100 years. Because the worth of a soul is valued given the factor of timelessness and eternity. And a very good preacher who studied mathematics put it this way. And he's a preacher in Lagos, Nigeria. He says, if you take Ebuse and Tamilore. Hey, Tamilore, Ebuse, we have an assignment for you. You see how young they are? I didn't pick their daddy, so I'm picking them. I said, Tamilore and Ebuse, your daddy are not going to join you in this assignment. And where is your daddy living? I'll give you a good place, VI. Okay, your dad lives in VI. Oh, VI is. I'll give you a jota. Say your dad lives in this particular location. And then you see the Atlantic Ocean. You see the lagoon. We call it lagoon. And he's going to travel. Or let's use New Zealand. Let's use, where are we now? Okay, let's use Avon Head. Your parents live in Avon Head. But you're going to go to what? Wait on. Help me now. Which of the oceans? Which of the?
Ocean.
Which of the seas is closer here?
New Brighton
from Avon Head. You're gonna say Tamilore and Ebuse. You will take a cup, just a cup, not a bucket, not a bowl, just a cup. Both of you will go to New Brighton from Avon Head, and you are going to empty the sea from New Brighton and relocate it to Avon Head. Clap your hand and celebrate that assignment. Good assignment for the kids. He says, by the time Tamilore. How many years do you think it's going to take Tamilore and Ebuse to finish the assignment?
Their whole life.
He says by the time they finish the assignment, if at all they finish the assignment, eternity has just started.
What about a tsunami?
A tsunami can move it. Move it to Avon Head. That's scientific. But we have given the assignment to Ebuse. Praise the name of the Lord and Tamilore. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, it's good to create these jokes in the midst of it, but Luce, listen to me. This is my point. When a soul is born, it's born forever. When a soul is lost, it's lost forever. This is because every human being is created to last forever. Praise the name of the Lord. The soul lives forever and will be presented to God to give account for the things that he has done right or wrong. If it's in Christ's righteousness, is justified. If that soul is still in his own self-righteousness or religious righteousness, is condemned. The soul, not the body. While we are alive, your body can suffer from fornication when you have sexually transmitted diseases or people have cancer for smoking. But in eternity, it is only the soul that suffers for the sin that is done. The soul will suffer for the sin committed in the body because the soul is the only part of you that is going to live forever. There's this true life story. You know the story very well. In Luke chapter 16, I'm going to paraphrase. It's the story of the rich man and Lazarus. And let me just give you some few lights about it. Number one, the rich man, while he was alive, spent his lifetime feeding his body with the best food and fine linen. But one thing he did, which was bad, he neglected his spirit man and his soul. Do you know that what is the pursuit of all of us? What is making us not to want to serve God? What is making us, the pews are empty in not just in our church, go to town. The pew are empty on Sunday because people will not want to give up a sheep for God. They wouldn't want to. What are they servicing? You think they are servicing their soul? If they are servicing their soul, they will be in church. You think they are servicing their spirit? If they are servicing that spirit, they will be in church. It's about the body. And that same body one day will collapse and go back to dust. And that was the mistake of the rich man. He focuses all his attention on his body. Have you seen anybody that went to heaven with Bentley? You've seen somebody that they buried with Ferrari. When he died, they count how many Ferrari he owns. And say, put them in the hole. Use one as pillow for him. So there's one Ferrari on his pillow and one Bentley supporting his leg. Maybe it was only in the eastern part of Nigeria I saw where they bury people with money. And I said, wasting money? Bromane's hometown. Where is he? I went to Iruekwe one day and I saw them burying people and they were throwing money into the grave ground. I said, that is the money she's going to spend in heaven. I said, eh? I'm sure some people will come back and pick those money. Guess what? What kind of money were they putting? 5 naira. I didn't see 100 naira. I didn't see 1,000 naira notes. Bro, Manuel, they bury people with money in your state. You know that. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Number two thing that the rich man did that was wrong was this. The rich man deliberately ignored the yearnings of his soul. His soul was calling for attention. The soul had that inner craving for its maker God. The soul kept on telling him, don't miss church on Sunday, at least. Give God the whole of your Sunday alone, at least. Attend Bible Sunday at least once a week. But he ignored it. The rich man also ignored the cry of the poor. And the Bible says, whosoever does not hear the cry of a poor man, himself will cry and God will not hear him. Number three thing, mistake the rich man did. The rich man died. And his body was buried, but his soul was transported into eternity immediately. The poor man also died because the same thing will happen to the rich happened to the poor. And the poor man was buried. Both of their souls live on forever. So don't forget it. Only the soul, out of the three, the body, the soul, and the spirit will live forever. Number four, there will be no repentance or restitution for the soul after death. I know Catholicism prays for the repose of the souls of the dead. I know preachers preaches about purgatory. That when you die, they will send you a temporary hellfire. And that hellfire is going to fire you up and burn all the sin in your body. And then they will send you to heaven. They are all lies. This story is a true life story. And if it didn't happen in this true life story that Jesus told, why? How do you know it's a true life story? Theologian says Jesus mentioned names. This is one of the parables that Jesus mentioned names. So they believe that this was a true life story. Again, Romans chapter 3, verse 23 tells us, and I've come short of the glory of God. The soul now left alone will stand in the place of judgment. Number 5, this is the most interesting part. When every show had finished, praise the name of the Lord. When every show had finished, you know what happened? I will close now. And I want to close with you so that we can have some time to pray. When every show has finished, you know, this rich man realized that his soul will live forever. You know what he did? He said, please, I've got 5 brothers. They are enjoying like I am enjoying now on earth. Please, Father Abraham, can you send them? Where are those hot, red-headed evangelists? Please send them to heart. I don't want my brothers to come to this place. You know what? Heaven have decided, even before he said it, no prayer for the unconverted will be answered in eternity. So it's a waste of time to pray for the convictions of sin that are of people that are dead. And no evangelism are allowed in eternity. The only grace, the only opportunity, the only time that we have now is to evangelize. Church, we are the tail end of life and history. The end time injury time is here. And the unfinished task, as announced by our Lord, is still very much unfinished. This land that we live is filled with lovers of pleasure, unchurched people, people who would rather go to the mall and worship the God of consumption rather than the God of heaven every Sunday, whose heart must be touched and converted to become lovers of God. God has sent you to this land for that purpose. God has allowed you to listen to me for that purpose. Please rise up and fulfill that purpose. This land is full of haters of the very God who created them. They hated God and they are raising children to hate God. May God use me. Say amen for me.
Amen.
Every job that we have, every house, every new house that we move is an opportunity to do something in that place. May God use me. Say amen for me. May God use me.
Amen.
At least if I say, may God use me,
God use you. You
will now say amen to your whole. May God use you.
Amen.
So they will be saved and become lovers of God. It is important as we close that we do not only try to win soul by just winning soul. We must learn to pray for the salvation of people. In Galatians chapter 4 verse 19, quickly. In Galatians chapter 4 verse 19. Don't forget, Jesus Christ says, none of us can go into a strong man's house. I only look Galatians chapter 4 verse 19. Without binding the strong man. And then we go into the strong man's house and then we're going to be able to spoil his goods. Praise the name of the Lord. It is important. I told some people yesterday that came for the community Bible study. Satan loves prayerless preachers. Satan loves prayerless singers. Praise the name of the Lord. Because you know you are not going to make impact. Look at Galatians chapter 4 verse 19 quickly as we close. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. That's why don't be discouraged about people you have preached to. Keep praying for them. Praise the name of the Lord. There are some people that I've pursued, I've prayed for as members of this church. Sometimes I feel discouraged. Sometimes I just tell myself I keep praying for them until they see the light. Praise the name of the Lord. That there is more to life than trying to satisfy everything that will please our body. Praise the name of the Lord. Prayer is the soul winner's secret. Prevailing prayer is the soul winner, is the harvester's key. When praying for souls of men to be saved from sin, we must pray in hope as we plow in hope. Fundamentally, our prayer must focus on 3 segments. Number 1, we must pray before we go out to preach the gospel, according to Luke chapter 11, verse 21 to 23. Number 2, we must pray as we are preaching the gospel of Margaret May. It says, though that soul in tears shall come back rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves with him. And after we have won those souls, after you have gone out to win souls, you must also pray for them. That's where there must be pre-evangelical prayers, evangelistic outreach prayers. There must be prayer as the evangelism is going on. And you must pray also after the evangelism has been done. As a matter of fact, as we are going about the field that day, you can be praying and God, lead me to some people. I'm telling you, I have amazing testimony of people I've met in the streets I just meet them in the street for the first time. I've never met them before. I preach to them. Today, they are my children in the Lord. God can do anything through us. Praise the name of the Lord. So what are we to pray for? If you are asking. And then we close. What are we to pray for? If you say, I don't know what to pray. You can write them down. You can ask for Sharon to send it to you. And then we close. What are we to pray for? Let's have the list. Number one, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers to his work. Hallelujah. What are we to pray for? The church needs laborers. So pray that every department, pray that people will arise in this land and preach the gospel and not be intimidated. Praise the name of the Lord. When I resume at a particular job, my manager, who was a former police officer, you know, did a detailed report on me and said, I saw you preaching. I saw some of your YouTube messages. You're a preacher. I didn't say you should continue to your preacher. And he said, this person did this in this office. You know? And he was like cautioning me. Praise the name of the Lord. I still preach the gospel, but I didn't flow the complete policy. They didn't say you shouldn't preach. They just say you should not intimidate people with your message. Praise the name of the Lord. If somebody comes to my house to greet me, what stops me from preaching to them? Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I pray that God will give us wisdom to preach the gospel.
Amen.
May the enemy not silence our mouth.
Amen.
We must pray for blind eyes. Some of them are blind, to be open and to be kept open after salvation. Number three, pray for hardened heart. There are some hearts that have been hardened. They are like iron. You should pray that God will make them to be melted. Scriptures are there for you. Number four, you should pray for them until Christ be formed in them. Until Christ be formed in them. Number five, pray until the Lord comes and reach righteousness upon New Zealand, upon any land where you are located. Number six, pray for a pass for God's word in this land. According to Amos chapter 11, 8 verse 11 to 12. Let people just begin to thirst for the word of God. Let the statistics of people that are buying Bible increase. I thought during the pandemic, people will buy more Bibles to find out why the pandemic has happened. The people on this part of the world read. Rather, they are trying to make law to take Bibles from the libraries. Let's pray also like Jacob prayed in Genesis chapter 30 verse 1. And let me tell you this. This is where I close. If you say, I've been born again. If you don't pray this prayer, last prayer point, you will never become a soul winner in your life. Let's begin until winning soul becomes one of your greatest prayer points. You must learn to pray like Jacob prayed. You know, it wasn't Jacob, actually. It was Rachel that went to Jacob and said, give me children, lest I die. I thought she would die, but she never died. She got children. And somebody used it to compose a song to win soul, actually. Praise the name of the Lord. So you must get to a point in your life that you say, Lord, I too want to have a child. I too want a star to my name when I get to heaven. Give me children, lest I die. Let's rise up on our feet and say, Father, give me children, lest I die. Make me a soul winner. In the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Father, Lord, give me children lest I die. Make me a soul winner. Can you think of somebody in your neighborhood? Can you think of somebody in your family? Can you think of a friend? Can you think of a friend? Some of us, we have close friends that are not in the Lord. It is not proper not to share the gospel with them. Please, give me children lest I die. And that songwriter that used that scripture to compose his song, he says, give me, Lord, children, lest I die. Give me, Lord, children, lest I die. Say, time is winding to a close. Soon the saints will be raptured. Must I go and empty and dead while others go with the fruit of their womb? Hear my cry. Hear my call. Hear my cry. Lord, I pray, give me children. Lord Jesus, lest I die. Say, Father, before this year runs out, make me a soul winner. Help me to begin to make friends for Jesus. Must I go an empty handed? Can we have the song, sir? In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And if you are listening to us online, can we just quickly do this? Can you join me in faith that somebody will listen to us online? Raise up your hand and join me in faith. You can do your hand like this and join me in faith. I don't know. When the YouTube is ready, you can share it too with somebody that needs to be born again. Somebody that is wasting the opportunities for his soul to come back to the Lord. Are you listening to us on Facebook? Are you watching this on YouTube? Are you in the service perhaps and you are not born again? And you know that your soul, when it appears before God to live forever, is going to be condemned to a Christless eternity. And you want to take that decision today. You want to take that decision today. Put your hand to your chest and say this after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I know my soul is going to live forever. I know my soul is dirty with immoral thoughts and different kind of sins. Lord, I'm sorry for the way that I've lived. I come back today not to pursue the things that pleases my body, but to pursue things that will please my soul, so that my soul today will put on the righteousness of Christ. Lord, wash my soul clean with your blood and give me the power to go and see no more. Thank you, faithful Father. And Lord, I pray for everyone that have heard me today, that are your children, make them soul winners. And let not this message die in our hearts. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Quickly, this announcement, I will just say it again. On the 26th, we are going now to make a friend for Jesus. We have a vest. If you don't have one, you can book one by talking to Sister Tofumi. I guess she will arrive before that time. Just tell her your size and she'll book one for you once you pay. Two, if you don't want to book the vest, just get your blue jeans. I'm trying to get some Bibles and we're going to get tracts. Just put your blue jeans with your white shirt. Any white shirt that is attractive. We pray that that day will be a sunny day. Saturday, December 26th, between 11:30 and 1:30, 2 hours. It's not African time, it's not Nigerian time, it's God's time. We start 11:30 and by 1:30 we are out of the place. So don't come late. We'll just spend some time at the Magrebe. We'll take pictures, we also have fun too. We drink, we eat with the people, but we share the gospel for 2 hours. And then we'll leave. Please, I'm begging us. Let's do it together, church. Clap your hands and celebrate God.
May we all be on our feet as we take the hymn together. Thank you.
mentioned today is actually takes into consideration exactly what we work on through this year, praise the Lord, and how the Lord has actually shown us victory despite all we went through, praise the Lord. Our prayer is that you're blessed as you listen in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Belongs to you, Lord.
Share it with your contacts and don't forget to like and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Stay blessed.